Dixie, I think that's another good idea. You might want to start with a setting. Where's all this dog washing going to take place?
The next plan, like he did with his walking business.
Or, yeah, as Nathan said, you might start off by coming up with a plan for getting all these dogs washed.
I think you need some details from the first story that kind of leads into.
Yeah. Allie, yeah, any ideas on the top of your head what those details might look like?
You could just introduce it by saying, kind of giving a brief summary of what happened in our first passage.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I think think that would be a good idea. By the way, all of those would be good ideas to include in the beginning of your story. And let me be clear, you don't have to include all of those. Those are just some examples, okay? What about the middle of your story? What might happen in the middle? What's your reader going to want to know?
What kind of obstacles he faced?
Yeah, you're probably going to want to start washing dogs, have Max start washing some dogs. Yeah, why not start with Roxy? That seems like a good idea.
Depending on how you interpret it, the first story.
Is he going to continue?
If something happens in his dog washing business, is he going to stop that and decide something else he's going to do?
Good. Yep. Good ideas. What about the ending of your story? Last part.
Add something else and have three businesses.
Yep.
Max's next great idea.
You got it. All right, what we've just done is a little bit of talking about what aspect of the writing process? Planning. Students, I think when they're with us and when they're on their own, need to think through the writing process. Step one, I would say, is understand the prompt. Slow down, man. Seriously. And I say this because, did I talk about this with you yesterday? I was notorious when I was in grade 3 for working too fast for stuff. Yeah. I mean, I have a ton of empathy for kids who just race through stuff, because I was exactly like that when I was in third grade. I also made the comment yesterday that I think it would have been a big difference in my life had somebody, one of my teachers, not just written that on my report card, but came alongside me and modeled what it looks like to slow down. That would have made a big difference, I think. I think the light bulbs would have gone on if somebody had done that. And of course, we can do that, right? In the classroom context. So slow down a little bit, think through what's being asked here, and then, one of the details that I got from reading the prompt carefully is that I've got to write my own story. What does that mean? Beginning, middle, end, right? Okay. What are some small number of things that might happen in the beginning of my story? What about the middle? What about the end? Approximately how much time would I need to take on that?
Our problem is we tell them this and we show them this and we teach them this, but when we do like the graded practice that we send in, graded, they don't do it.
Huh. Insights into why? That's an interesting comment, Nathan made.
We did a practice writing test not too long ago, and we spent a week and a half, 2 weeks, just reviewing and reminding and going over the writing process. We went through the plan. We went through everything up till the day before, and then the day of the test, there's no planning. There's no pre-writing. There's maybe one or two sentences. They wrote only one paragraph.
Turn it in. Yep. Okay. A common issue. Kayla, you got a thought about that?
My students are like real concerned about this going in the grade book. And I'm not going to lie to them, but and I don't just say no, because I know what I'm going to get. If I just say no, I tell them no, but this is an excellent way for us to know how we need to help you, because we will get results back on this writing. We will know how to help you, and you can do way better on the milestones when it comes around. This is like a practice run for milestones, you know, and so I explain away, and then, but it's only the students who want help and who care about doing better on milestones and who the milestones has meaning to them, you know, that actually go through with it. Some students don't understand the importance of that test or don't comprehend the magnitude of what that test does for them and us, and you know,
right.
And so those students are just, is it affecting whether or not I'm going to get my allowance when my report card comes out or not? Is it affecting my new PlayStation game or not? you know, if it's going in the grade book, I'm gonna do, you know, and I'm not gonna lie, but I don't know.
So is it going in the grade book?
No. Not what he was talking about, the right score that we send in and get feedback on that they do. That doesn't, no, it doesn't. But we could do ones that do, and we do, I mean, we do, in their writing course, they do write for a grade, you know, sometimes. With a rubric, you know, but that's why we see those. Because some students don't, I'm not saying they don't care, but they don't understand that they need to care more. You know, they don't, we try so hard to make them understand, but some are just not going to do that.
Yeah.
I see a lack of confidence in kids.
Yep.
Like, we constantly read them stories by authors, like these big people that have like written books. And when it comes time for them to write, they're like looking at those books and they're like, this is what I'm supposed to write? And I mean, their confidence level is down. Mm-hmm. So it's almost like they're stuck because they're like, I want my story to be really, really good. You know, and they take time to think it out, and then when it comes time, they write it down, and then they don't have time to finish it to the perfection they want.
Yeah.
Because we show them all these books that are just like, you know, fantastic. We don't show them the behind the scenes kind of thing.
It can be a little deflating if you're looking at texts that have been written by a bunch of adults.
Yeah,
right.
Like, how in the world am I ever gonna achieve what this writer is achieving?
Right.
Even some of the best mentor texts are actually written by whom?
The children.
That's right, peers.
Yeah.
So we're going to dive into some actual third grade kids' responses to this prompt in just a second. Along the lines of what you just said, I think the kid who made the top score on the scale is just, I might hesitate showing all my third grade kids this kid's response, because it's really good. I mean, it's like in the top one half of 1%. I mean, very few third grade kids with whom I've worked write this well and read as well as this kid is reading. But I'll tell you what, the kid who made the next score down, score 0.3, which is a really good score, I think a lot of kids could lock into what this kid is saying and then even do better. So I'm actually going to start you with the kid who made 3 points on this assignment, which is a really good score. Think about the rubric for end of grade assessment. It goes 4, 3, and then 2, 1. The zero is for the non-scorables. So basically, you cut the rubric in half, and you've got the threes and the fours, and those kids are on point. The twos and the ones, really, there's generally something to look at and say, all right, we can take this a step further, but they're in the bottom half. I do want to come back and briefly talk about what Kayla said. There's part of it, like, are we really any different? I mean, do we need to know the purpose behind why we're doing what we're doing?
Yes. I like to know.
I think there is a time and a place for truly formative assessment. If motivation is an issue and actually following through and then putting a grade in the grade book on an assignment that we're asking our students to spend a lot of time on, would it be the worst thing in the world to put that in the grade book? I mean, it's a rhetorical question. I mean, I don't have a great answer to it. I could argue either of those points. But, excuse me, what I'm saying is that there's part of me that understands why an 8-year-old is reasoning things through in that way. You know what I'm saying? So would it be devastating to put that in the grade book? I mean, I'm asking you to put a lot of effort into this. You're gonna have something to show for it. Yeah. This is not just gonna go away and fly off in the wind. There's something tangible here. So give it your best. Yeah. I was like that.
Would you feel that same way about like a benchmark assessment that they spend a lot of time on?
I mean, aren't your benchmark assessments, how are they used? Are they just used to get a sense of, like how, because you know, different districts use benchmarks for different purposes.
Right.
So how are they used in?
They're used to find out what the child knows after you teach it.
Yeah.
And if you need to form small groups for remediation, or if you need, you know, we use the data to for our next plan.
Sure. Yeah. So I'm assuming that that score is not put into any kind of a grade book?
No.
Okay. I mean, I'm not here to tell you that it should or it shouldn't be, but I wonder if you would actually get a better showing from your students if you did. You know what I'm saying? That's it. I don't mean to step on anybody's toes. One of the things that, of course, we talk about in assessment courses at UGA is measurement error. What is measurement error? We're giving kids some kind of a test. Sorry, I'm going to nerd out for just a second on assessment. Okay, bear with me. What's the purpose of the assessment?
To find out what they know.
To get some understanding of developing mastery of some content. Is the assessment perfect?
No.
What are some reasons that the assessment could be imperfect?
Motivation of the student.
That's a huge factor. Motivation of the student. There are others that we could talk about, but let's hone in on that one. We're making an assumption that students are going to do the best that they can. That's an assumption that is routinely violated. And so I think it's important to think through creating an environment where we can get the best showing out of our students. You're right. I mean, some students are intrinsically behind in terms of general motivation. Some kids, however, I think, just based on my experience working with kids, are motivated or not because they don't really see the consequences associated with it.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, sometimes.
So I think it's a good internal, I'm not telling you how to think about this. All I'm saying is that you might actually get better, you might get a better sense of how your kids are doing if there are some consequences associated with, for instance, a benchmark. That's an internal conversation we all need to have. But I mean, it's a good thing to think through. Because motivation is, as Summer said, a huge, huge factor in terms of the quality of the data that you get. We can't know everything about students and what they... If there were some magic opportunity for us to just get inside our kids' heads and get a sense of what do you know and what do you not know about some content, then we wouldn't need an assessment. We wouldn't need this tool. But we have to use these tools, and we're trying to make the tools as solid as possible.
But when you have kids that are behind, to me, growth is more important.
Yeah, elaborate on that.
Well, I mean, you've got to consider where they're coming from, their background. Do they get up at 2 o'clock in the morning and take care of all their siblings, or do they, not go to bed till 2 o'clock in the morning? Because they were, did they get themselves up? Did they get the rest of the family up?
Yes.
Did they get on the bus? Or, most of them don't have help for homework. You have to look at variations of teams. Like for us, we have the more, I'm not going to say.
Leading team.
Right. Whereas they have a higher.
Sure.
They have higher thinking kids. And there's a huge difference between those kids have somebody to help. Most of them have somebody at home every night that sits down with them, does their homework, make sure they're, in the bed at a certain time, they've had a bath, they've been fed. Whereas our kids, we don't know that necessarily every day.
Sure.
And some days they may perform better than others. And to me, sometimes growth is just showing growth. They have learned something. It just doesn't, but it doesn't reflect on their grade.
Their grade doesn't reflect on their grade.
I'm in full agreement.
And that's where, too, like the milestones, they have to show growth for the milestones. So they don't necessarily have to make a 3 or a 4 on it this year, depending on what they made last year. And they need to make the
least. And that's why I think benchmarks for us, growth is more important for us. Benchmarks.
Yeah.
Because benchmarks when it's a grade.
A grade.
We've got a kid in fourth grade.
But the ones that you're.
First grade level, they're not going to pass a fourth grade standard. But if they show enough growth to show, hey, maybe I'm up two grade levels this year.
Yeah.
I'm on a third grade level when I'm doing a fifth. That's a successful year to that kid.
Oh, totally. And my point, and I can't agree with you both more. All I'm saying is that, I mean, the growth could be a part of the, if you wanted to put some grade in some grade book, it could be fully related to the growth that the student has shown. Does that make sense?
Because that's how you do their daily grades, right? I mean, right? Or no. Like, are you scared to use a benchmark for a kid that's already failing anyway as a grade? Because if you put a benchmark in as a grade for a kid that's already failing, it's not going to affect their score negatively or positively, really. But if your daily grades are based on growth and they're doing good on those shorter daily grades, then the benchmark is going to impact negatively. And you don't want that when they're growing. I completely agree with that. Because those shorter daily grades are easier for students. Doesn't have to hold their attention as long. There's so many factors that go into just the length of it, period. Not the content at all. Because benchmarks are wrong.
Yeah.
Overwhelming.
Okay, back to the narrative. An important conversation to have. Oh, what in the world does this sentence mean? That's good to talk about with students. It does not mean what it means in short answer. Remember? You just did a short answer. I think Max's dog washing business is going to be really successful. And then you gave textual details to back up your answer. A lot of you actually cited source as well. According to dog business, blah, 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 blah. And then you either gave a direct quote or a paraphrase of a detail. That's different in the narrative. What does this sentence mean?
The structure, the characters, the frame, the basic setting.
Yes. Well said. It's a good sentence to talk about with students. Along the lines of what Megan said, I phrase it a little bit differently. The kinds of things Max and Roxy do and say in your story should be like the things Max and Roxy do in dog business. So there needs to be some connection. All right. We've already talked about the writing process. Let me say one last thing, and I don't have your students in mind. Nathan brought up a really good point. Some kids just flat don't want to plan. It takes a long time. And I don't have any of your students in mind. Sometimes when I've worked with, well, actually, let me rephrase. When I have worked with those kinds of students, sometimes a good solution is to help them develop a planning approach that is very straightforward and doesn't take much time or effort. But nevertheless, get some thinking through, all right, I need to prep myself here. Now, that's not a silver bullet. It's not going to be a kind of situation where every kid's going to be convinced of that. It's helpful with some kids, though. Even if you just said to yourself, all right, I need a beginning, middle, and end here. And just thought through, what are some of the things that are going to be included in my beginning, middle, and end? That's better than no planning, in my view.
Do you have a magic template?
No. If anybody tells you that there's a magic template for writing instruction, run for the hills.
Well, we've shown them short, just like, no more than like this big, just phrases, non-full sentences. We've shown them this is a quick way to do it, and this tells you what each paragraph or what this paragraph's going to be about. Just simple phrases, but getting that out of them.
Yeah, I hear you. Yeah, I know who you're talking about. I know the kid you're talking about.
I wanted to share something that worked for me.
Yeah.
Like, with my kids, when we did the planning, like, they love movies, they love looking at pictures. They would draw six boxes, and they would have two boxes for the beginning, two boxes for the middle, two boxes for the end. They could kind of visually draw it out.
I like it.
And also put the dialogue, like, with the bubbles. So that really motivated a lot of my kids.
I like it. What a nice corollary to movies. Actually, good example. Any other examples that you have from your own teaching that have been helpful for students who are reluctant to do some planning?
I give mine a lot of options. I model several up front at the beginning of the year, and they always have access to the organizers, or some of them choose to draw it on their own.
Uh-huh.
But let them choose what works best for them.
Yep.
And not say, you have to use this diagram to do this task. They can choose which one works for them.
Get a variety of options. Good. Any other thoughts on that? Okay. We'll come back to the four. Let's start with the three, though. Okay. If you make a three, that's a really good score. You are using, I've highlighted bullet three here. You're using pretty good technique. Dialogue, description, in particular. The three compared to the four generally has one part of the story where you feel like there's a little bit of let up when it comes to like dialogue, description. It's a little underdeveloped from the standpoint of technique. Score point four, on the other hand, there's not much let up. It's pretty consistent. My sense is that you'll be able to tell what part of this student response, which made 3 points, is a little bit underdeveloped from the standpoint of technique. Here goes. It was a good first day. Pretty solid stuff here for the most part. Agreed? What happens in the beginning of this student story?
He wakes up.
Wake up. Kind of a little bit of what it's what comes to mind in terms of what Dixie said, kind of like establishing a setting. What happens in the middle of this story? Picks up Roxy. The ending, what happens in the ending? Job done. What part of this story do you feel is a little bit underdeveloped? Yeah, I agree. I think the ending could use a little bit more detail. What would be a golden opportunity for the student to include more detail during what part of an ending?
When he's washing the dogs.
Yeah, like what is that experience like? Remember, Roxy's all caked in mud. You said it. A few more sentences on what it was like to get all. I love this expression that you use. You washed all the brown away. That's really good. But was it easy? Was it a struggle? Did you have to hold Roxy down? What was that like? I think the reader would really like to learn those details. Bless you. I think if this student added those details at the end, it was a really good response. Pretty good connection to the story? I think so. And the student didn't write a tremendous amount.
Was it written just like this?
Just like this. I think this student's handle on grammar is actually really solid for a third grade kid. Impressive grammar and conventions.
Definitely.
Yeah, there's some vocabulary here that's pretty advanced. By the way, these are exemplars that the Department of Education released. Let me ask you this. We talked about using
student-produced mentor texts as good examples to talk about with students. Do you think that this would be a good one to show third grade kids?
Yeah.
You know what? It can be very heartening for students to know, like, all right, tell me about what you're expecting in terms of volume in my story. I think this gives a pretty good frame of reference for third grade kids. And if you write like a solid couple paragraphs here, I mean, if you did begin, middle, end, you'd probably talk about three, right? I think you could well say that this kid has three paragraphs. The student has just failed to do what? That's right. I mean, this didn't indent or didn't skip lines in between paragraphs. But that's pretty solid. Careful reading. I think this kid has planned as well. One other thing that I would say, and again, not a silver bullet, but in terms of the writer's process, reminding kids and doing some one-on-one conferencing with them, especially the reluctant kid, the kid who's reluctant to plan, about just creating and kind of an attitude. I mean, this is what we do as good writers. This is an expectation that I have for you and that you should have for me, because I'm gonna be writing with you, right? And this is just stuff that we do. This is just stuff. Planning, for instance, is what good writers do. And again, I want to be clear. I'm not saying that that's going to solve all of the problems. But kind of a shift in mindset, yes, among some, yeah, students can be very helpful. I tell you what, especially if you throw yourself in the mix,
yeah,
and you're a writer with your students just as they are writers. So everything that they do, I do.
I like to ask them what they would do differently about my writing.
Yes.
So they can see that I'm flawed too, or like,
yes,
maybe I didn't have,
well,
the best,
said,
idea in the room or whatever.
Oh yeah, and do the same thing with your plan. You know, let me show you how I planned. What would you do differently?
You don't have to be perfect to be good at it.
Yeah, you don't have to be perfect to be good. That is a mantra to hold dearly in literacy instruction. Really, instruction in any subject area.
Yeah.
You don't have to be perfect to be good. That's really well said, Kayla.
I tell myself that. Yes. About adult things. Okay?
Yes. Isn't there a book that's come out in the last year or so that's basically, that's the thesis? Stop worrying about perfection. Like, it's not a thing.
It's not a thing.
It's not a thing.
Nope.
Let's just settle on that, okay? But it doesn't mean that you can't do really good work.
Right.
All right. The two. We are going into the bottom half of the rubric now. Twos have fairly decent connection to the story. In other words, this kid has read the story. You'll see that. It's going to be clear to you that this student has read the story, comprehended the story, comprehended the prompt to a degree, but technique, dialogue, description, is there. It's attempted, but not very successfully. Here's a good example of a two. Since Roxy got all dirty yesterday, Max decided to start washing dogs. He would need customers first. Max would go through his neighborhood and advertise himself like his parents did with the Smiths. Max would set up the dog washing at his house. Max would need to set a price for each wash. Max will get started this weekend.
Yeah, it didn't really use that
other passage. Yes, well said. Good intro here. If this were my student, in between, let's say this is what we get after draft one. Keep everything you have here. But as you move into draft two, I want to learn a little bit more about what?
The body of it.
I mean, yeah. like what you've told me kind of everything that you need to get going. Now, get going. What was it like washing Roxy or other dogs? Was it easy? Was it hard? What happened? And then what happened in the end? Was it? Did you do a good job? Did it fail? So, hold on to everything you have here, and let's just take it a step further. You know, it can be very disheartening for students is to have to take something that they drafted and then just like put it to the scrap heap. Mm-hmm. You know, that's not, sometimes that's the best course of action. Just take a new route. A lot of times, though, you can salvage what you got here. All right, one more. Score point one. Oh, this is a little bit, you'll see what I'm talking about.
Okay.
I don't like this as an example of a one. I almost can't believe that he's got a one. I mean, I think you would probably, I would more likely give which score?
Well, don't be scoring ours this year.
I would not go zero here. Why?
Because it's actually the first day.
That's true.
It's relevant.
I mean, the other one, I honestly, I think this one is actually a bit more effective than the previous example. Yeah. I mean, this kid actually writes a story.
Yeah.